starting with Spider-Man's lost PSAs. In 1990, the Learning Company distributed a series of animated educational VHS tapes called the Spider-Man Safety Series. The tapes were made by CoroNet/MTI Films and Video with the purpose of tackling serious social issues that children might be facing and how to deal with them. The tapes were distributed to elementary schools across the United States, complete with lesson plans to guide teachers in how to present the material. Because the Spider-Man Safety Series was exclusively sold to schools, there was no way for the general public to own a copy, and in the years since the release, have never made their way online. With the exception of one, the single surviving tape titled Don't Hide Abuse was saved by the YouTube channel Mindless Shelf Indulgence, who found the tape while working at a public library, taking it home when he found it was going to be discarded with a pile of other VHS tapes, as the library was moving to DVD and Blu-ray formats. 15 years later, Mindless Shelf Indulgence realized that the tape could not be found anywhere and promptly posted it to YouTube. This 11-minute short, targeted towards second graders, addresses physical abuse. In the tape, a little girl named Maria is being abused by her father. Her friends and classmates see her bruises and ask Spider-Man for help, who convinces Maria to tell a trusted adult. Obviously, this is a very serious topic. Children absolutely need to know that this is not okay and have access to help. But the tape has that typical old-school PSA vibe, where they mean well, but it just comes off as funny or even has disturbing implications. Like, there's a scene where Spider-Man sees Maria being hit and doesn't intervene. I know that's not the point, but to see Spider-Man just let it happen is so messed up. Over the years, other tapes were identified through old library archives. A tape titled Smart Kids Play It Safe, and another one called What to Do About Drugs. But no library still had a copy. Lost Media Wiki user Rogue Knight contacted the publisher, and they actually got back to him, giving the search some more information. The series was acquired by Fox and licensed back to the Learning Company. The contract was to expire in 2005, but all underlying rights lie with Park. They also informed Rogue Knight of the title of a fourth and final tape, Where Do You Go for Help? The publisher said they would let him know if they found anything, but they have over 6,000 tapes in their collection. They suggested contacting Fox. While making this video, I contacted the publishers, and they said they don't have the tapes. I reached out to Marvel. I haven't heard anything back, and I'm not really getting my hopes up. There are no screenshots or covers for the three missing tapes, but we have a full synopsis of Smart Kids Play It Safe and a brief description of What to Do About Drugs. In this video, Spider-Man invites viewers to follow his friends, EJ, Timmy, Maria, and Jason, on their way home from elementary school and discover how they handle the secret safety tests he has arranged. Spider-Man's friends prove they are responsible for following the 7 safety rules he's taught them. Spider-Man, Smart Kids Play It Safe, is a children's safety guide about walking home from school and being home alone. The program is fully animated with a multicultural cast of characters. When Timmy, an elementary school student, is offered drugs by 2 very persuasive older boys, his friends enlist the help of Spider-Man to teach him about drugs and making good decisions. Our best lead on the most elusive tape of them all, Where Do You Go for Help, is that at one point it was in the possession of a public library in New York State. There are no plans for a re-release, and it seems the only hope of recovering these lost tapes is if someone comes forward.
Whether 'tis in order to join this jazzy group or group or to evade the slings and arrows of Brandrook.
Does mother know you wear us for drapes?
The first live-action Captain America. The Marvel Super Heroes was a 1966 animated TV series airing on various stations across North America. The show was produced by Grant Ray and Lawrence Animation, who also produced the 1967 animated Spider-Man series, best known for the iconic Spider-Man theme song that's still used by Disney today, and of course, the long-running meme. The Marvel Super Heroes initially ran as its own 30-minute program made up of 3 7-minute segments, but was eventually broken up, and segments were used as filler in children's TV programs. The show featured 5 Marvel Avengers, Captain America, Iron Man, Thor, Hulk, and Namor. Most episodes were solo adventures, following just one character, but there were occasionally episodes that featured the whole squad and other Marvel characters like the Fantastic Four, the X-Men, Ant-Man and the Wasp, Bucky, Black Widow, Loki, and Hawkeye. 65 full episodes were produced, made up of 195 segments, airing from September to December of 1966. The show's stories were ripped directly from the Silver Age comics of Jack Kirby, Steve Ditko, and Don Heck, literally. To save animation costs, comic panels were directly scanned and then lightly animated. But every single one of these lightly animated episodes of the Marvel Superheroes are easy to find today. But when broadcasting on WNAC-TV in Boston, Massachusetts, the station wanted to do something different. In between animated segments, WNAC included live-action segments hosted by actor Arthur Pierce, dressed as Captain America, which by all accounts is the case. character's very first live-action appearance. These live-action skits, exclusive to the Boston area, were also known to include the likes of Dr. Doom, the Hulk, and even Cap's reunion with Bucky. But based on Arthur Pierce's own recollection, it did not follow the Winter Soldier storyline. The only known piece of Arthur Pierce's live-action segments come from a low-quality bootleg recording by a viewer who recorded them with a black-and-white Super 8 camera and a reel-to-reel tape recorder near the TV speaker. And it's not clear how many of the live-action segments were made, but there is one very interesting aspect to these local live-action skits. It's so strange, I really have a hard time believing. These skits were not improvisations by a local TV host like I expected, but were scripted by Superman co-creator Jerry Siegel. You heard that right. The co-creator of the most iconic DC superhero played a hand in this Marvel TV program. The claim is sourced from a 2010 book, Age of TV Heroes, that states Pierce and Siegel were friends. And Siegel did briefly work for Marvel in the 60s, so this isn't completely unheard of, but it would be one of the only times Siegel would ever work on a TV show. Because of shady business dealings by the station's parent company, RKO General, WNAC Boston signed off at 1 a.m. on May 22nd, 1982. It's unclear what became of the film reels containing the first live-action performance of Captain America. Sam. Sam Raimi's lost Spidey scenes. Like with every movie, there are things that are filmed that we will never see. Most of these are just outtakes or a different take of the same scene. But on occasion, there will be extended takes or even complete scenes that were filmed but are never released to the public. Now, maybe the studio holds on to every piece of film they shoot, but I would wager that these extraneous scenes that don't even make it to a home media release are probably discarded. And 20 years later, I fear the same may have happened to one of the greatest superhero trilogies of all time, Sam Raimi's Spider-Man. And just for the record, I love Spider-Man 3. The dance scene is supposed to be cringe. It's what Peter Parker thinks being cool is like, fighting. A good amount of deleted scenes were included on the trilogy's DVD releases, even a version of Spider-Man 2 called Spider-Man 2.1, with new, alternate, and extended scenes. But others are yet to be seen by the public. Some of these lost, deleted, and extended scenes have been found in some really strange ways. In October 2015, the YouTube channel ChrisTheGeek517 uploaded a short clip from Spider-Man 2 that comes from an airing of the movie on FX in the 2000s. The scene doesn't really add much. It just shows Peter chaining up his bike to a pole before going into his apartment. No idea why only the TV version includes this scene. In August 2020, a Twitter user posted another unseen clip from Spider-Man 2 that the user claims they got from stock footage on Sony's website. The clip is an extended version of the early pizza delivery scene. That same month, the YouTube channel EPH00 posted more clips, the first being scenes of the cut character Dr. Wallace. This now partially found scene shows the remnants of a deleted subplot where Sandman repays slash intimidate Dr. Wallace into making a cure for his daughter's illness. EPH00 also posted two very short clips that hint at an alternate death scene of Venom. This alternate version of Spider-Man defeating Venom was used in the movie's novelization, and though it appears to have been filmed, and we can even see some of the CGI work was done in the film's Comic-Con trailer, the alternate scene would have had the symbiote consuming Eddie Brock, leaving a skeleton, and Spider-Man finishing off the symbiote with a sonic attack. Apparently, the scene was shown to test audiences who didn't like the symbiote consuming Brock, and the scene was redone into what we got in the final film. Despite extended cuts being released, the trilogy's continued popularity, and the bits and pieces we have recovered, there are still a good number of scenes that remain elusive. I'll link to the Lost Media Wiki page on the trilogy's lost deleted scenes if you want a full, but possibly incomplete list of the scenes. Marlon Brando's final performance. Big Bug Man is a mysterious animated superhero movie scheduled for a release in 2006 before being pushed back to 2007, then to 2008, and never being heard from again, but never officially canceled. It's not clear when the movie's production began, but we know it was well into development by mid-2004 because the film will be the very last project worked on by Marlon Brando and his only animated role. Brando, best known for his iconic performance as Vito Corleone in The Godfather, was originally asked to play the character Nicholas Dunderbeck, but thought it would be more fun to play the old woman, Mrs. Sauer. By this time in his life, Brando was on oxygen for 6 hours a day, so all his lines were recorded for Big Bug Man in his own home in a single day. He got so into the role that he dressed as the character, wearing a blonde wig, dress, white gloves, and full makeup while recording his lines. He said it was the most fun he had since playing Julius Caesar. His lines were recorded on June 10th, 2004, and he passed away just a few weeks later on July 1st. Alongside Brando was Brendan Fraser, who played the lead, Howard Kai, a worker at a candy factory who's bitten by bugs, becoming the superhero, Big Bug Man. Believe it or not, this is an original character. They came up with this high-concept brainbuster all on their own. The movie was directed by Bob Benderson, with Peter Shin as animation director and Maurice Tobias as voice director. All of them had only worked on TV until this point, which could be a possible reason for the film's tumultuous development. The movie was traditionally animated and cost about $20 million to make. It also starred Michael Madsen, best known for his role as Mr. Blonde in Reservoir Dogs. But we don't know what character he played in Big Bug Man. Despite numerous release dates being set, a single second of this film has been released. No teaser or trailer of any kind. All we have are storyboards, the movie's poster, and audio snippets of Brando's performance as Mrs. Sauer that were reported on by news stations. There's never been any reason given as to why the film remains unreleased, but the most obvious reason is that it was canceled because Brando died. But this is pretty flawed. Mainly that the movie wasn't canceled immediately after Brando's death, just continuously pushed back. Maybe the plot changed over development and they needed more lines from Brando to make it work, but this also doesn't completely make sense. His character, Mrs. Sauer, only had three scenes. With such a big name in the movie, I'm sure they could have worked with the voice books they had. But to me, it almost seems disrespectful that they didn't release the film after Brando was so excited to voice the character. And even if his performance wasn't flawless, no one's gonna hold it against him. Dude was 80 and on his deathbed. By some accounts, the movie never made it past the storyboard phase. Meaning, we may never hear Marlon Brando's final performance. The Josh Trank Cut. Studios have a long history of butchering their superhero movies against the director's wishes. Richard Donner was famously fired from Superman 2 with 75% of the film complete, and of course, Warner Brothers kept the tradition alive by massacring the original release of the Justice League. But these both have a happy ending. In both cases, the directors were allowed to return to restore their films, with Superman 2 with the Richard Donner cut and the Snyder cut. But in the case of 2015's Fantastic Four, it's never had its happy ending. Stylized as fan horsestick, this film might be the single worst superhero movie of all time. At least something terrible like Catwoman is fun to laugh at, but fan horsestick is just boring. Scoring a scathing 9% on Rotten Tomatoes and a 27 out of 100 on Metacritic. Basically, the studio wasn't happy with the original cut director Josh Trank turned in and mandated rushed, ill-planned reshoots. In one of the most obvious cases, you can see Sue Storm's hair change within the same scene. It's kind of hard to even describe, but the movie has no second act. They spend an hour on the characters gaining their powers, and then there's a final battle. And with previous Fantastic Four films were maybe too light in tone, the reboot overcorrected, making the tone way too dark, and ditching much of the family dynamic that made the comics so compelling. But, unlike in the cases of Superman 2 and the Justice League, where the studio is largely to blame, director Josh Trank isn't completely innocent in this whole mess. The movie was originally written by Jeremy Slater with a more comic-accurate tone, but as the film progressed and Fox gave Josh Trank notes on the script, he just never told Slater and took it upon himself to rewrite parts of the movie. According to Slater, I never saw 95% of those notes. Slater would leave the film, and Simon Kinberg was brought on to help write. This, combined with Trank's erratic, sometimes abusive behavior on set, and Fox's dissatisfaction with his first cut of the film, he was locked out of the editing room, losing final edit privileges. Steven Rifkin was brought on to re-edit the film, and in Trank's words, Rifkin ultimately chose different takes for every single scene of the movie, and became the de facto director. But as far as Trank's version of the film, by the time he delivered his first cut, the ending hadn't been finalized, still going through visual effects. So the studio cobbled together an ending partially based on Jeremy Slater's script, and new sections were filmed, sometimes being written on the day of reshoots. Trank's planned cut of the film was a little over 2 hours versus the final hour and 40 minute version. This final cut removed a good number of scenes that were shown off in the trailer and marketing. According to Trank, because he still needed to shoot a few scenes and a few visual effects were still left unfinished, this combined with the movie's commercial failure and a reboot coming up by Marvel, it is very unlikely that the director's cut will ever materialize. There are 5 deleted scenes that you know from Trank's vision. An action set piece where the Thing dives from a plane attacking a terrorist camp, but for budget issues. Dialogue between Reed Richards and